Thank you. linen cloths, and wrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloth. The year is 1773. The medieval Christchurch Cathedral has been demolished under the guiding eye of Waterford architect John Roberts. Once the seat of the Roman Catholic Church, but since the 16th century Reformation, introduced by Queen Elizabeth I of England, it has been a place of Anglican worship. Roberts is building a new cathedral more suited to Anglican worship. In 123 years, a heavenly secret is revealed. They had rediscovered the only surviving set of medieval high mass vestments in Northern Europe. The remarkable discovery posed many questions. Where did they come from? Who owned them? Who hid them here? And why? For answers, we must go back to the Florence of Lorenzo de' Medici in 15th century Italy, the center of the luxury textile industry. A Florentine speciality was velvet brocade on cloth of gold ground with pomegranate design. The thread is real gold, the cloth of kings, princes, and popes. Once our cloth of gold was woven and ready for the next stage, it was sent to Bruges in Flanders. Here the panels were skillfully embroidered with scenes from the Bible and the vestments assembled. Artists of the caliber of Jan van Eyck or Hans Memling designed the panels, and these artists were inspired by the religious imagery of their day. Although the scenes are from the life of Christ, the details of dress and building style are of Bruges in the 1460s. The precious vestments were wrapped and shipped to the thriving port city of Waterford. The devout dean of Waterford Cathedral, John Collin, who lived in the deanery building on this site here, anxiously awaited their arrival. In John Collin, we meet a cleric who, like most of his late medieval contemporaries, was obsessed with death and purgatory. That fateful place where people believe the eternal soul will be tormented until the sins of this life had been purged. In preparation for his day of judgment, Collin built a chantry chapel onto the cathedral, where priests would say masses for his soul and the souls of the benefactors of his chapel. Collin raised money to build and furnish this chantry chapel by collecting the so-called God's penny, a donation by ship captains to ensure God's protection on the high seas sailing between Waterford and cities in Flanders like Bruges. Collin was given letters from Rome allowing him to grant indulgences, which promised a shorter time in purgatory to those who gave generously, such as very successful merchants like James Rice, Collin's pious friend, 11 times mayor of the city, and so concerned with purgatory that he gave 6 properties, including the wine cellar in the basement of this museum, to Collin's chantry chapel. Collin provided the priests celebrating Mass in his chapel with these cloth of gold vestments, the most magnificent then available. The enormous generosity of the citizens of Waterford and their obsession with purgatory are reflected in the 3-meter-long rent roll, listing the gifts of property and the income they brought to the church. Before going on a second pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela in Spain, James Rice also built his own chantry chapel and placed there a gruesome tomb, a reminder of death to his fellow citizens. In 1483, the same year that Rice returned from Spain, Martin Luther was born in Germany. His objections in 1517 to the sale of indulgences will unleash a tidal wave of religious reformation that, when it reaches Irish shores, will sweep before it Dean Collins' church and even his vestments. In England, King Henry VIII initially earned the title, still displayed on English coins, Fidei Defensor, Defender of the Faith, for defending the Catholic Church against Luther. But when he needed a legitimate male heir, and therefore a divorce, he broke with Rome and declared himself head of the church in England and Ireland. He also closed the monasteries. Henry's daughter, Elizabeth I, tightened England's grip on Ireland and established the Anglican Church here, and the Roman Catholics lost control of the cathedral. In an effort to stop their silver plate and the vestments falling into the hands of the new Anglican Church, the Roman Catholic cathedral clergy placed them in the custody of the Catholic City Council in 1577 for a pledge of £400. When Queen Elizabeth I died in 1603, Irish Catholics expected concessions from her successor, King James I. In a mood of expectation, the cathedral and other churches in the city were seized, reconsecrated, and purified by the Catholic bishop. Mass was once again celebrated, with the clergy wearing the now 140-year-old vestments. But their joy was short-lived. King James, as head of the Anglican Church, did not approve of the actions of the Catholics, and ordered that the cathedral be restored to the Anglicans. However, the Catholic City Council recovered their vestments. Because successive Roman Catholic mayors of Waterford refused to take the oath that accepted King James and not the Pope as head of the church, the city council was finally suspended in 1617. A disaster for proud, independent Waterford. The civic regalia and royal charters were all taken to Dublin. And as for Dean Collins' vestments, as state and religion coalesced, collided, and diverged, their remarkable tug-of-war continued. James's son, Charles, succeeded him in 1625. Facing bankruptcy, he issued a new charter to Waterford, restoring the city council. The charter cost £3,000, raised by the merchant class, anxious to begin trading legally again. In 1637, King Charles, through his Lord Deputy Wentworth, ordered that the vestments be handed over to the cathedral to be used by the clergy of the Anglican Church. And so, the vestments were now used in the celebration of divine service for 5 years. And this might have continued were it not for the 1641 rebellion, when ferocious raids were launched against new Protestant settlers in Ulster, and a massacre of Protestants began. As the rebellion spread, the Catholics in Waterford regained control of the city and the cathedral. And so, in another roll of the Wheel of Fortune, the vestments were once again used for the celebration of Catholic Mass. The rebellion was further complicated by the outbreak of civil war in England between the supporters of King Charles I and the Parliament. Enter a name as feared in Ireland as it is renowned in England, Oliver Cromwell. After the defeat and execution of Charles I by Parliament, the Puritan Cromwell ruled England. To restore order in Ireland, in 1649 he landed with his new model army, declaring, "No mass will be said where I rule." He had a score and a kingdom to settle. By November, he was outside the gates of Waterford. Waterford was the only city in Ireland that he failed to capture. Fearing for the safety of their precious vestments, the Catholic clergy of the cathedral collected them, now almost 200 years old, wrapped them carefully, sealed them in a large iron chest, and, taking an oath of secrecy, buried them in a specially constructed vault that was set into the floor of the cathedral and awaited the inevitable. 8 months later, the city fell to Ireton, Cromwell's son-in-law. His victory ensured the Roman Catholics of Waterford lost control of Christchurch Cathedral forever. The Cromwellians ransacked the cathedral, taking away the gold and silver and even brass organ pipes to melt down for cannon. But they did not find the vestments. They remained hidden for 123 years until the medieval cathedral was demolished in 1773 and replaced with a magnificent new building. Which brings us full circle and to the explosive rediscovery of John Collins' vestments. By the late 18th century, Ireland was becoming a more tolerant place. On their discovery, the Anglican bishop, realizing that the vestments dated to before the Reformation, gave them to the Catholic dean in a gesture of goodwill. 20 years later, in 1793, with almost all of the anti-Catholic legislation repealed, John Roberts began building a new Roman Catholic cathedral. The only architect in Europe to build both Catholic and Anglican cathedrals in the same city. When the cathedral opened in 1796, the vestments were worn once again to celebrate High Mass in the splendid setting of the first Catholic cathedral to be built in the British Isles since the Reformation. Today, the vestments are symbols of our shared Christian heritage and of how tolerance triumphed over intolerance. They are a celebration of the extraordinary skill and artistry of the craftspeople who made them, and the religious devotion of the many who helped acquire them and keep them safe over the centuries. After a 550-year-long journey, the vestments have now returned home to this museum, the site of the medieval deanery. For the people of Waterford, they are a tangible link with the art of devotion that so occupied the minds of our medieval ancestors. Had I the heavens embroidered cloths, and wrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half-light, I would spread the cloths under your feet. But I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams.
My name is William Wythe. I was twice mayor of Waterford, and more importantly, the boyhood friend of Henry VIII, King of England and Ireland, knighted me. So you may call me Sir William. I'm going to tell you a tale of wine and war, of not two great neighboring wars in the longest legal dispute in Irish history, and produce this famous document, the Great Charter Roll of Waterford. Saved our city in its darkest hour. International trade has been the lifeblood of Waterford City since 914, when Viking raiders and traders first settled here on the banks of the river shore. My ancestors came here in 1171, when King Henry II began the conquest of this island. In those days, Waterford was the only port in this great harbor. King Henry recognized Waterford as the gateway to Ireland and took it for himself, making it a royal city. Some of the English lords who came here were jealous of Waterford's prosperity. Men like William Marshall, a crusader knight of humble origins, who acquired lands in France, England, and the vast lordship of Leinster here in Ireland, simply by marrying Isabel, the only child of Strongbow and Aoife McMurrogh, whose marriage in this city was at the very centre of the English conquest of Ireland. Marshall and Isabel quickly developed their lordship of Leinster, producing huge surpluses for export. Rather than pay taxes to the king and make Dublin and Waterford merchants rich, Marshall set up a rival port called New Ross in 1207 on the banks of the River Arran. King John visited Ireland, landing at Waterford. To gain approval for his new port, the crafty Marshall took the king hunting deer around New Ross. Marshall also built a hook lighthouse at the entrance of the harbour to guide ships safely to his port. As ships began to bypass Waterford, Marshall's coffers were being filled with silver. For the first time ever, Waterford had to share the harbour with a rival port. Objections to New Ross by the men of Waterford fell on deaf ears. As King John lay dying, he made matters worse by putting Marshall in charge of England until King John's son was old enough to rule. In this powerful position, Marshall ordered that ships could ply through the lands of William Marshall, the King's guardian, thus bypassing Waterford for New Ross. It was only when the aging Marshall retired to a life of religious devotion as a Templar knight that this city's complaints were listened to. The new King Henry III recognized the challenge to his royal court and the income he got from it. He ordered that all ships entering Waterford Harbour must unload at Waterford. But following objections from Marshall's son and successor in 1222, the king came up with a compromise. He allowed ships coming from the Marshall lands to go freely to New Ross, but all other ships must touch at Waterford. The king also ordered Waterford to build three ships for the defence of the realm. To this day, they are emblazoned on this city's coat of arms. It was very difficult for the Waterford merchants to prove that ships bypassing Waterford and going to New Ross had not come from Marshall lands. Wine was the most popular drink in Ireland, and Waterford was one of the few ports allowed by law to import it. It was here that the king's wine tax was collected. Merchants trying to evade paying this tax began smuggling wine to New Ross. To make smuggling wine to New Ross less attractive, King Henry III issued this charter to Waterford in 1232, generously granting the city the right to charge only half the normal royal tax on wine. Bitterness continued between the two courts. The king might well make a law, but enforcing it was a different matter. His governors were constantly sending sheriffs to New Ross to search for wine ships and confiscate their cargoes if they had bypassed Waterford. In 1266, Waterford merchants took the law into their own hands and went downriver, forcing ships to unload at Waterford. This led to open warfare, and in one battle, two men were killed. The king ordered a tribunal, and Judge Alexander of Nottingham was sent from England. Here we have the names of the witnesses who testified to this piracy of the merchants of New Ross. The very next year, the king's governor, David de Barry, was ordered to New Ross to take for the king's use the goods of any ship that had bypassed Waterford illegally. Despite this, New Ross was thriving. They were so puffed up with pride that they decided to make a city of their town. They walled in an area of land so big it rivaled in size both Waterford and Dublin. The walling of New Ross is celebrated in a poem preserved in this ancient volume that came into our hands when His Majesty King Henry VIII closed the Franciscan Friary here. Now, here we are. On Sunday, the fair ladies of New Ross rode. In 1275, very year the wool tax was introduced, Governor Geoffrey de Joinville ordered the Sheriff of Dublin to take for the king both ship and cargo of any mariner who landed in New Ross and had not come from the Marshall Lands. This was repeated twice under Governor Robert Offord in 1277. In 1281, the Waterford city was at the very height of its prosperity. It was burned down, some say by accident, others by the men of New Ross who had lighted torches into the cellars of merchants. In 1292, when the wine ship the Alice from Harwich was arrested for illegally entering the port of Ross, the men of that town demanded an inquiry into Waterford's monopoly on wine. The inquiry found in Waterford's favour. In reaction, the Lord of Ross offered to collect the wine tax in Ross and pay it to the king, but Edward I rejected this, thus securing the prosperity of his royal port of Waterford. The now familiar order to stop ships bypassing Waterford for New Ross continued to ring out across the Irish Sea. In 1348, a cargo that nobody wanted entered the Irish ports. Black Death. A plague wiped out over a third of our cities. Misfortune followed misfortune for Waterford until King Edward III issued this charter in 1356, stating that all ships, with no exceptions, entering the harbour must unload at Waterford. This was a great victory for the Royal Port of Waterford. But the celebrations did not last long. 5 years later, the city suffered a humiliating defeat when it was attacked by the combined forces of the powers of County Waterford and the O'Driscolls of County Cork. 36 chief citizens and 60 foreign merchants were killed along with the mayor, John Mallas. The new mayor wrote to the king about the city's dire situation, and the king confirmed the 1356 charter. This was reconfirmed in 1371 by Governor William of Windsor. New Ross lodged yet another objection. This was not the first inquiry that the men of Waterford had to face, but it would be the last. They fought back not with a sword, but with a pen. So in 1372, the city officials searched their archive for documents and compiled this great charter roll by stitching them all together. Then they did something unprecedented. They decorated the roll with images to flatter the king. And to prove to him the long, unbroken line of support for Waterford by all the kings and their governors, stretching back six generations to King Henry II, in 1171. Mayor Lombard brought the charter roll to London, where he presented it to King Edward III. The roll achieved its objective. Waterford's claim to be the premier port in the harbour was upheld. Although the bitter antagonism dragged on for another 150 years, the port of Waterford had won the day. I well recall the last great battle between the men of New Ross and the men of Waterford on the 20th of May in the year of our Lord, 1580. I am proud to say that my kinsman, James Wise, was one of the 34 citizens of Waterford who, under the command of the mayor, had a resounding victory. The men of New Ross complained that the men of Waterford led the attack together with French, Spanish, Breton, and Irish mercenaries. They were dressed in surcoats, coats of mail, helmets with shields, spears, swords, lances, crossbows, bows, arrows, broad axes, and cannons. New Ross was forced to pay Waterford a fine of £100 in silver and to deliver unto us a trophy of our victory, the New Ross mace valued at £20. It was I, Sir William Wise, who 10 years later, in 1528, finally ended this 300-year-long dispute when I was this city's ambassador to the royal court. I reminded my boyhood friend, King Henry VIII, that his father, Henry VII, had called Waterford herbs intacta than it, an untaken city, because it had never fallen into the hands of the king's enemies. His Majesty, understanding full well our loyalty, ordered his advisor, Sir Thomas More, and the great Cardinal Wolsey, the Chancellor, to ensure that Waterford's position as premier port in the harbour was never again challenged. Ever since the Anglo-Normans, or English, came to Ireland, the merchants of this city relied on international trade and the protection of the king and his courts when doing business. We have always been loyal to whoever sat on the throne of England. Our business is overseas trade. Politics is for others. Herbs intacta manet Waterfordica, or as you might say, Waterford, the untaken city.